Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. How and when did the asteroids and comets in our solar system form? For many decades, astronomers have embraced the story that these small rocky bodies are the primordial leftovers of our solar system's formation, supposedly from a nebular cloud 4.5 billion years ago. Of course, as viewers of this series have long known, science discovery has done little to nothing to support this view. In fact, one of the great surprises of the space age is that asteroids and comet nuclei appear remarkably similar. They have complex, rocky, and rubble-strewn surfaces. The Electric Universe has always proposed the, quote, radical hypothesis that comets, asteroids, and meteoroids were torn from planetary surfaces by interplanetary lightning in an epoch of planetary instability. A major piece of this puzzle is the evidence for electrical scarring on planets and moons, and one of the most dramatic examples of such scarring may be the enormous trench Valles Marineris on Mars. In this episode, retired nuclear engineer Ray Gallucci offers an independent analysis of the specific role that Mars may have played in creating the asteroid belt.
Today, I'd like to talk on the plausibility of the electrical birth of the asteroid belt from the Electric Universe perspective. Some background on the asteroid belt. Traditionally, the asteroid belt formed from the primordial solar nebula as a group of planetesimals form protoplanets, and this is taken from the asteroid belt discussion in Wikipedia. Between Mars and Jupiter, however, gravitational perturbations from Jupiter imbued the protoplanets with too much orbital energy for them to accrete into a planet. The collisions became too violent, and most of the protoplanets shattered. As a result, 99.9% of the asteroid belt's original mass was lost in the first 100 million years. Now, on the Electric Universe theory, the EU theory of asteroid formation does not require that one object smash into another one for there to be craters. And there's a discussion video on thunderbolts.info, Dawn Approaches the Asteroid Belt, and I'll be taking some quotes from there. Electric arcs can gouge surfaces and scoop out material, accelerating it into space, leaving clean, deep pits. Comets also exhibit surface features that are the same as those observed on asteroids, so the conclusion is that the two are really one thing and not, quote, dirty snowballs versus rocky bodies. Let's talk about Vesta, which is the second largest asteroid. Vesta, with a diameter of approximately 530 kilometers, compares to Saturn's moon Enceladus, or Mimas, in size, again taken from that Thunderbolts presentation. There are indications that Vesta has experienced some powerful collisions in the past, since one of the craters near Vesta's south pole is 460 kilometers in diameter, which is more than 80% of the asteroid's size. The crater is close to 13 kilometers below the mean elevation of the terrain, with a rim about 6 kilometers above. There is an 18-kilometer-high central peak as well. The question that's asked in the Electric Universe presentation is, why did an impact that removed more than 1% of the asteroid's mass not blast it into pieces, especially given that the size of the crater is almost the size of the diameter of the asteroid itself? Continuing with Vesta, other asteroids, as well as small moons, exhibit craters that should have exploded them into fragments when they were hit. According to gravity-based models, they are loosely compacted and act like big sand piles and absorb the impacts without shattering. They have no hard crust to begin with, so they haven't fractured despite repeated pounding. Plasma arcs do not disturb the surrounding surfaces when they are used in industrial applications. Based on laboratory analysis, that is what has occurred on Vesta and on all the asteroids, moons, and planets of the solar system. Plasma discharge erosion. So again, that's the Electric Universe theory. Now let's look at the Valles Marineris on Mars. And this is taken from the Wikipedia entry on Valles Marineris. This is a system of canyons that runs more than 4,000 kilometers long, that's 2,500 miles. It's 200 kilometers wide, that's 120 miles, and it's up to 7 kilometers deep, or 23,000 feet. It's one of the larger canyons of the solar system. Valles Marineris is located along the equator of Mars and stretches for nearly a quarter of the planet's circumference. It has recently been suggested that Valles Marineris is a large tectonic crack formed as the crust thickened and was subsequently widened by erosion. Some channels may have been formed by water or carbon dioxide. And this is the Wikipedia explanation of Valles Marineris, and this is what the mainstream physics holds, that it's all due to tectonic activities. The picture shows there, you can see how long Valles Marineris is. I mean, it is a huge surface feature on Mars itself. And we note that in the 1970s, the engineer Ralph Jurgens first proposed that Valles Marineris is the scar left by a giant interplanetary lightning bolt, not necessarily a tectonic activity. Let's talk about an analogy with laboratory plasma. Recently, geologic researcher Michael Steinbacher and experimentalist Billy Yelverton, exploring the theory of planetary electrical scarring, have collaborated to replicate the complex conditions that might have been present in an epoch of planetary instability. And this is taken from the Thunderbolts video, Valles Marineris in the Laboratory, a space news from 2015. And there's a picture there of the scarring that was done in the laboratory. And my observation is even the most jaded skeptic should admit some resemblance to Valles Marineris. If you just go back to the previous slide and you look at the picture of Valles Marineris there, and then you look at the laboratory version of the plasma scarring, I think it's pretty obvious that there's certainly a similarity. So now I would like to consider if Mars was the sole source of the asteroid belt. So rather than delve into the electrical plasma arc discharge as the potential creator of Valles Marineris, I'm going to focus on the mass of Mars' surface potentially ejected during such an encounter with a closely passing planetesimal, comparable in size to the largest of the known asteroids, which happens to be also known as dwarf planets now that Pluto's been demoted, and this asteroid is Ceres. I'm going to take an independent look and see, is the amount of mass in the asteroid belt consistent with what might have been ejected from Mars? The maximum amount of Mars' surface ejected during such an encounter would have been, there's a calculation there based on the volume of the depth and expanse of Valles Marineris, it calculates out to 2.2 times 10 to the 19th kilograms. From the estimated total mass of the asteroid belt, which is about 3 times 10 to the 21st kilograms, more than 100 times greater than the maximum estimated mass that could have been ejected from Valles Marineris, ejection solely of Mars surface material could not have generated the entire asteroid belt. It's about a factor of 100 too small. Not that it could not have contributed to it, but we need to find some other mass in order to account for the asteroid belt. Let's consider a contribution from a planetesimal. The total mass of the asteroid belt, 3 times 10 to the 21st kilogram, with less than 1% arising from Mars itself, that 3 times 10 to the 21st kilogram, that would be the minimal mass needed for the planetesimal if it were completely disintegrated and its debris contained within the belt. Again, I'm going to just talk about a collision, or not a collision, but an interaction, an electrical interaction between Mars and one planetesimal. I mean, there could have been multiple, but let's look at if it had one, and what would the size of that one planetesimal have had to been? Let's assume the same density as the largest asteroid or dwarf planet, which is Ceres. The corresponding radius would have been the cube root of this formula here, which is based on the size of the mass of the asteroid belt, the mean density of Ceres, etc. It would have had, this planetesimal would have had to have a radius of 690 kilometers. Ceres itself has a mass just under 10 to the 21st kilograms and a radius of 473 kilometers. So the postulated planetesimal would have been roughly 3 times as massive and 50% wider than the currently known largest asteroid, which is Ceres. Let's put this in some perspective. Mars itself has a mass of 6.4 times 10 to the 23rd kilogram and a radius of 3,390 kilometers. So the planetesimal would have been only about 0.5% as massive and 2% as wide as Mars. Quite a small entity, but certainly not far out of line with Ceres. If this was all going to come from one planetesimal, the asteroid belt, in an interaction with Mars, it would not have had to been much that much larger than Ceres, which is the largest one currently known. Despite the Moon being roughly 25% the width of the Earth, in other words, 1,737 kilometers versus 6,371 kilometers, we note that its mass is only slightly above 1% that of Earth, which is around 7.3 times 10 to the 22nd kilograms versus Earth's mass of just under 6 times 10 to the 24th kilograms. The ratio of the Moon's mass to that of Earth is only about twice the ratio of the proposed planetesimal to that of Mars, despite a much greater difference in size. I mean, the Moon is quite large compared to the Earth itself, as moons go relative to their planets. And so what Mars would have needed for this interaction would have been something a lot smaller than our own Moon. Therefore, the planetesimal need only have been comparably as dense as other known asteroids to have generated the asteroid belt via an electrical discharge interaction with Mars. So, in conclusion, is the electric universe theory's explanation for the formation of the asteroid belt plausible, at least from the perspective of the amount of mass involved? I did a crude analysis, and I have a positive answer to that. However, I leave it to the electric universe theorists to continue their explanation of the phenomenology and its plausibility, towards which they appear to be off to a good start.